Welcome to this session on the subject, the WTO and Sustainable Development, an agenda for the General Council. I welcome you to the TDS if it's your first session, but I'm not sure. I'm very sure you've attended many other sessions. So welcome to this particular session. We're pleased to be hosting this discussion. In terms of context of this panel, one of the most interesting parts of the UN's 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development is the invitation that can be found in paragraph 86 of the Addis Ababa Action Agenda to the World Trade Organization General Council to consider what WTO's contribution could be to sustainable development. There does not appear to have been discussions on how the WTO General Council will respond to this invitation and what steps will be taken to contribute to the new development agenda. The objective of this session is to discuss the response of the WTO General Council to the invitation and to specifically identify what key contributions WTO could make to sustainable development in the next 15 years. As you are aware, we are coming from the Millennium Development Goals agenda, which governed the last 15 years. And the WTO was, a partner, a development partner in that regard. The SDGs, SDG 17, still, you know, has a component of, you know, a development partnership. And so we want to see how the WTO's role could be. May I introduce the panelists that are here with me. To my immediate right, Christoph Bellman is a senior resident research fellow at the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development. You will find the detailed bios on the website of the TDS. And then I have next to my left, Dr. Deb Bhattacharya, who is a distinguished fellow from the Center for Policy Dialogue and is also chair of Southern Voice on Post-MDGs, International Development Goals. I then have Jamie DeMello. Jamie DeMello is currently a distinguished emeritus professor from the University of Geneva. And then I have to my far right, Dr. Yao Ansu is the chief economist from the African Center for Economic Transformation, and the only lady on the panel who deserves a special mention is Dr. Mia Mikic, head trade policy and analysis section of the Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. I was privileged to share a panel just a few minutes ago with her. Colleagues, welcome to this discussion. Considering the time limitations that we have, I'll take this opportunity to invite Christoph to set the stage for this discussion. What do you see WTO's role in this in response to this invitation from the Addis Ababa Action Agenda? Christoph.
Well, thank you very much, Darlington. What I'll try to do is focus on a few small set of issues, essentially two areas, where I think the WTO can contribute to the advancement of the 2030 development agenda, and colleagues on the panel will probably address other aspects. I'll try to focus on food security and agriculture as one area, and second on fisheries and some of the sustainability concerns that we have. These are both areas that are already, if you want, on the agenda of the WTO, but the world has evolved. A number of new developments have occurred, and it's important to maybe revisit a little bit this issue. On food security, well, you know that the 2030 agenda basically wants to end hunger by 2030, doubling agricultural productivity, small farmers' income, adopt climate-resilient food systems. And clearly, we know that trade is going to be a very important part of this equation. Trade has grown almost threefold over the last 15 years, and is likely to continue in the next decade as income and urban population grows, particularly in Africa and Asia. And many of these countries will rely more and more on imports and exports of food. Markets are increasingly thin, and also are likely to be more and more concentrated, particularly on the export side, which means that we have a number of risks that can be associated, risks such as shocks related to climate change or disruptive trade practices. Prices have become more volatile, and this volatility has been exacerbated by insulating policies in a number of countries. We've seen that during the price spike crisis, where export restrictions and other types of measures have further contributed to further volatility. We're seeing big trade distortions in subsidies coming back in the US, in the EU. We're seeing trade distortions increasing now in emerging economies. So there's a whole set of issues here that are becoming increasingly urgent and where disciplines in the WTO need to be updated. We're trying to get something on export subsidies here in Nairobi, but beyond that, we will need to have in the future some rules on export restrictions, on domestic support. We will need to find a solution on the issue of public stockholding for food security. We will probably need also some sort of a special safeguard mechanisms. How to get that, maybe that's probably something we can go back afterwards in the discussion, but I think that after Nairobi, we will need to rethink slightly the way in which we address those issues. There are a few avenues that one can explore, but again, I think we can come back later on in the discussion. The second topic, which I think is quite important, is fish. We know that fish is a heavily traded commodity, the most heavily traded agricultural commodity, actually, with almost 40% of production being exported. We know what the challenges are there. Overfishing affects 30% of the stocks, as far as we know. We need to eliminate illegal, unreported, and unregulated fisheries that causes loss of 10 to 23 billion a year, so huge, huge challenge. What we're seeing on the trade front is a number of countries, particularly the EU, the US, starting to use trade as a way to fight IUU fishing, but they're all using very kind of unilateral types of measures, which have been a little bit problematic, and they do that in a fairly uncoordinated approach. The other problem that we have is subsidies, 35 billions of subsidies provided every year. Rashid is here, he's been doing all the calculations. He tells us that 20 billion of these subsidies are capacity enhancing, contribute to overfishing. That's almost one fourth of the total value of landed fish. So exceedingly high figures. On fishery subsidies, there is a little bit of momentum happening. We've just had this TPP agreement, which for the first time has some interesting provisions on subsidies, prohibiting subsidies on illegal fishing, prohibiting subsidies that really affect overfished stocks. And I think we can build on this together with what we have in the 2030 agenda to try to revive the negotiations in the WTO. And this is already happening. This is one of the big issues being discussed as we speak now in the ministerial. We might have an outcome now. If not, I think we can really try to build on this and revive the negotiations there. Finally, a last word on this illegal IUU fishing. I think that we need to move from this set of unilateral bans and trade measures that some countries have adopted towards something of a more coordinated action among the bigger countries. We can start to use some of the regional trade agreements to move in that direction. We can use the TTIP between the US and the EU. If these two countries can agree on how we can block illegal fish from entering markets, if these two countries can use their RTAs to push for countries to ratify the port state measure agreement from the FAO, we could go a first step. But ultimately, and maybe that's a more kind of a long-term approach, I think that in the WTO we would need some type of provisions, agreements, disciplines that deal with illicit trade. And illicit trade is in fish, but is also in many other areas. But I think that's a contribution that the system could make. So these are just a few ideas to initiate the discussion. And I'm seeing on your chronometer that I just stick to 5 minutes. So
you've done very well. Thank you, Christoph. It seems most of what you are saying actually hinges on the negotiations' success in the WTO as a response to the food security question. I'll turn to Jamie and try and find out how can WTO respond in terms of WTO rules and climate change. What do you think the response is in that respect as a response of the WTO?
Thank you. Now? Yes, okay. Thank you very much for inviting me to this panel. Like many of us, I was last 2 weeks in Paris discussing the climate agreement, and it's pretty clear that we are sort of on track to do something. But the problem so far is we haven't done anything. So, you know, the issue of what is the relationship between the trade and climate regimes has not really been addressed because nothing has happened on the climate side. So we can assume that something is going to occur, and when something is going to occur, that is that some measures will be taken, then there's the possibility they'll be on a collision course. Now, of course, I use the word collision course just to get a bit of attention, but it's not so unrealistic, especially if we take into account the SDGs, because taking into the account the SDGs is we have to do more for the planet than just control the temperature. So, you know, if you just think about the planet boundaries that have been popularized by Rockstrom and Al, it just says that we just have so much to do that if these measures are taken, there are going to be reactions, and that's what I want to talk about. Now, what I like to do is just do it in two ways. One way is to say, what is the WTO regime now? And what I'm going to describe it very simply is as a negative contract. What I mean by a negative contract is that basically countries can do just about anything they want on their preferences, that is on environmental policies. It's maybe a simplification, but basically it's a negative contract. So as a negative contract, what can we do, or what can countries do, if some of them want to do something about the environment, whereas others don't? Now, why they wouldn't want to, there are all kinds of good reasons. Maybe I should develop first, clean up later. I mean, there are all kinds of reasons why we're not going to be moving at the same speed. So that's the negative contract. But what can you do under the negative contract? I'll speak for 2 minutes on that. And then after, I'll go to where should the WTO go so that there'll be, let's say, a synergy or complementarities between the trade and climate regimes so they won't be on collision course. And the argument is we should move towards a positive contract. Now, of course, as usual, it's easy to talk. It's easy to say. It's more difficult to do because countries may not have or do not have the incentives to do so, to give up some of the sovereignties that would be necessary to get this collective action. We know that. However, we can sort of ask what are the kinds of easy things to do first, and then I'll finish with the more ambitious ones. So what can you do in the PowerPoint, which I'll distribute, what can countries do? Well, basically, they can do border trade adjustments. Or in other words, if some countries want to do border trade adjustment, you can think of the CO2 prices that are not going to be converging rapidly enough, so there'll be leakage. You know, what is leakage? Maybe 30%. If you have border tax adjustment, maybe it'll be 15%. These are just rough orders of magnitude. But, you know, this will have to address the leakage problem because carbon prices will not be converging rapidly. So what can you do? Can you do something? Well, the answer is, well, probably if you look at what has been the legal case law, but of course we haven't had anything on case law on climate. We've had tuna, we've had other case law, but so far it looks like we can do something on that. What else? Can we do labeling? Labeling is another. If you want to have an environmental policy, another one is labeling. Now, on labeling, it's somewhat more complex. We're not so sure that countries can get away with labeling under the current system. One of the reasons is that in the end, the way the law has, well, let's say practical law or case law has worked so far, is to let the consumers decide. Now, you know, if you really want to become serious when I'm going to talk about where to go ahead, to go to a positive contract, then, you know, countries, you know, would have to agree, exactly how is another story, to make environmental policy part of something they have to address. Now, if you had that, then it would no longer be to the choice of the consumer to decide what is likable or not, because then, of course, you might take, to take an example, cement that's produced with CO2-intensive cement clinkers, you can't put a tax on it because, you know, the other one is the same product, but it's done in a more costly way, and the consumer will prefer the least costly one. So that's an example. The third, so this is a bit ambiguous. The third is green subsidies. Now, we have this Article 31 up until 2000, but that was not renewed. So we don't have the possibility now to have non-actionable green subsidies in the WTO. How important is that? Well, you know, right now maybe it's not that important, but if really you're going to want to go towards reducing carbon emissions and put a tax on carbon, then the industries are going, rightly or wrongly, well, they're going to scream and want to have some adjustment, and subsidies could be one adjustment. So that is something that should be explicitly allowed. So that's where we stand. So what would you want to do in a positive contract? So one of them, which is easy to do, and I think everyone agrees, and we've heard many discussions here in the last 3 days on this, is to go towards issue-based plurilaterals. Now, this is jargon maybe, but I mean the issue, right now most plurilaterals have been country-based preferential trade agreements. That's what we see everywhere. But of course now we're moving towards issue-based plurilaterals, and there are many kind of reasons why we want to do so. Among one of them, Patrick Lowe the other day reminded us that the WTO is not that good anymore at negotiating reduction in trade barriers. Just think about the EGA, which is an issue-based plurilateral, and we're moving more slowly than we were hoping for, right? And in fact, if you look at the details of it, there are 14 countries in there, 17 now. There are 7 of them have tariff zero on environmental goods list. Now, I'm talking not of the 54 APEC list, but even if you put 411 goods, environmental goods, you know, a lot of the countries negotiating have zero. Now, who are the ones that have something to negotiate? There's South Korea, China, and maybe New Zealand, if you look at the averages. But these are just, they're still low averages, and those countries, okay, first they may only want to move slowly to just make the applied equal, or sort of take the water out of the tariff and get the applied, bind the applied. But the point is, it's very difficult, you know, it's very difficult to get the countries yet to do something on that. Yet, you know, the EGA is a very interesting agreement because, you know, if it goes through, then you have really what you need. What you need to get really a climate policy that works. You need to get full participation. So you get full participation, okay? To do something that, yes, I'm done. Yes, okay. 1 minute? 1 minute, okay. Well, you're almost done, right? with because you have full participation. The second thing you would have is you would be doing something that would be costly, okay? And the third is you have dispute settlement. So you really have MRV, monitoring, reporting, verification, which is what we need. And the last point, though, is that is one aspect. The other aspect, which is more interesting, is to get around the free rider problem. And that's what Nordhaus and others have been saying. What we need is to have plurilaterals in which the members that are going to work in it can put punishments which are incentive compatible, which is a word to say it's in the interest of the punisher to punish, because in very many cases so far, the punishers will not punish because they're going to be hurt as well. But this would be possible if you had a club of countries that say you agree the OECD countries should do something about raising the carbon tax, and not the developing countries or the low-income countries. Well, you can simulate and show that if you take a carbon tax of maybe $20 or $30 a ton, then if you put a tariff that's not too high, then the guy who puts a tariff on the non-participant, then the non-participant loses because he doesn't get market access, and the punisher improves the terms of trade, and that's where it becomes incentive compatible. Okay, so that's the deeper changes that we need to be made. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. I'm sure we'll be coming back to you on your specific recommendations on how we can achieve this complementarity between our trade and climate change. May I turn to Deb? Deb, how can we achieve sustainable development in LDCs through the WTO? You have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. You and I have struggled in the WTO to get the LDCs issues and concerns established, and you know our level of success. And that's why we are here today in Nairobi in a twilight zone. We don't know whether the sun is going up or going down. So I will take on that question, but I want to have Jim said, is to have a positive contract with you that you will not stop me till I finish my intervention. But that's a joke. But coming to the issue, since this is about sustainable agenda for the General Council of the WTO, and you know what it means, once I got this invitation, I tried to prepare a memo for the WTO General Council, particularly from the perspective of the 2030 agenda and what it will mean for the WTO in many ways. If I get my time, I will contribute a piece to the bridges of ICTSD, which hopefully will be read by others. Let me come to these issues. You see, if you look at the 2030 agenda, then you will see at least four or five elements which concerns WTO directly. The first most important issue is it relates to the systemic concern. You see, we need to take a step back from all the ongoing issues and look at the framework issue. The number one issue is that it talks about that universal, rule-based, open, non-discriminatory, and equitable multilateral system under the WTO. Now, for each of these five adjectives, we will have to find measurable indicators or some kind of a tangible assessment clue what it means. And there is no time for that over here. What I want to draw your attention to, it talks about multilateral system under the WTO. It doesn't talk about international trading system per se. So I think this is a very important political point to note, that the future of the trading system which we aspire for has to be hinged, anchored in the WTO, and the implications are quite understood here, given what's happening in the rest of the world. The second important element which has implication for WTO trading system, for the first time, you know, the issue of equality has been brought into the global agenda. And at the goal 10 of SDGs, we are talking about, for the first time, not only about reducing the inequality within countries, but among countries. And trade has been considered to be one of the elements of doing that. And within that, if you look at the targets, and the indicators which are now being considered against that reducing inequality, the special and differential treatment, which has been considered with one of the modes of that. So my first point to the WTO General Council is that deal with the systemic issue, deal with multilateralism, strengthen the principles of openness, rule-based approach, and at the same time doing common but differential responsibilities and rights over there. So that is agenda number one. Number two, as Christoph and Jamie have mentioned, there are some ongoing issues on the table already. So what are the ongoing issues which they will have to deal with it? Obviously, one is fisheries subsidies issues. The other is food security issue. But the third one is no less important, agriculture export subsidies, which is, again, supposed to be a low-hanging fruit in many ways, as we see. And so these are some of the issues, ongoing issues, which we'll have to look into. And there is, of course, the third element is the related issues which are there. One related issue is the technical property right, the intellectual property right issues, definitely. There are issues which restrictions on trade. For the first time, we are distinguishing between good trade and bad trade in a global agenda, where the trade in small arms, trade in endangered species and fauna had been brought in, which has to gain more prominence in our discussion, not only liberalizing trade, but also managing trade in the right way. So the third element is that the other related issues. Now, let me come to the fourth point, which is the LDC. There are at least four elements on the LDCs which are there in the SDGs over there. One is market access, DFQF as fast as possible. The second is rules of origin on that over there. The third is the intellectual property right, where we got some space now up to 2033. So is the third one, and of course, and the fourth one is related to export targets. So there is an LDC package built into the SDGs as we go. The last point I want to say is that there are other related issues which are important, which doesn't get so much of attention, of course. Of course, there is aid for trade, which gets attention, but the issue of trade data. Trade data is very important in terms of ensuring the accountability process of the rule-based system as it goes. So I see the memo I have for the General Council, it has at least five elements over there, and the concluding task is that the Secretariat should prepare a memo which should go to the General Council as an agenda item, the responsibilities of WTO in order to pursue the global 2030 agenda over there. And one thing they can do immediately is to include these elements into the TPRM, the Trade Policy Review Mechanism, so that they can really be integrated into the global follow-ups and monitoring process as it goes. I see a big task out there. Thank you.
Thank you, Deb. Your last point, makes a lot of practical sense in order for us to use TPRM as a monetary mechanism. Seeing that we may have difficulties in traction on the negotiations and so forth, so TPRM may be used as a tool in this respect. May I now invite Yao Ansu, the Chief Economist, African Center for Economic Transformation, to give an African perspective of how sustainable economic transformation for Africa could be achieved through the WTO in view of the SDGs. Yao?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for inviting me. The SDGs, of course, have 17 goals and 169 targets and stopping disease and all of that. But to me, a key one that we could really resolve, policy or action around is SDG 8, which calls for pursuing sustained growth in a sustainable way, in a way that produces employment. And I say this because if incomes are rising and employment opportunities are increasing, that really reduces inequality within countries and also among countries. And then for Africa in particular, for us to do this, we need to raise education, we need to also increase our agriculture and industry. So one can go on that it could become form of a critical part. And so, to me, if WTO is going to contribute to the SDG agenda, then the question I ask myself is that how can WTO help promote sustained and sustainable growth in Africa? We all know that trade and growth are correlated, positively correlated. There's a two-way relationship. To trade, you need to be able to produce something that some others want that you can exchange for what they produce. And if you are not competitive in producing things that others want, then you are really not in the game. So beyond all these trade rules and all these things, is basically your capacity to be competitive in today's global economy. And for us, to me, for African countries, that's what really the key thing, point. I mean, historically, countries that have used trade to grow have effectively pursued a world-trodden path that includes maybe five-point strategy. The first is basically sensible economic fundamentals in the macro and private sector. But then beyond that, there have been specific, countries have pursued efficient import substitution strategies that used to include protection in the home market for their industries. They've pursued concerted export promotion subsidies that had included subsidies to their activities and to their firms. They've also concerted technology acquisition strategies that have included FDI and also reverse engineering of other products. And then when they've been successful in all of this, they become competitive, then they've liberalized and become respected members of the international club. Now come WTO, the role of domestic protection, the role of export subsidies, and the role of reverse engineering were all taken away through the ASCMs, the TRIMs, and then the TRIPs. And then to compensate, you have special and differential treatment, which is basically duty-free, quota-free, and then you have the Doha round that was supposed to improve market access, particularly in agricultural goods for developing countries. And then the TRIPS call for providing capacity and access to poor countries to technology. And then you also have trade facilitation and aid for trade. In all of these areas, it seems to me that there's a lot of work to be done. There's been a lot of talk, but not enough focus have been placed in order to really make good on the tools that were taken away with the promise of a compensation that haven't been delivered. For instance, if you take the special and differential treatment, the duty-free and quota-free have all kinds of problems that requires harmonization, particularly in terms of rules of origin. I find it very problematic, particularly in the African context, when we're trying to promote regional trade and integration, the artificial distinction between LDCs and developing countries. Kenya is a developing country, Tanzania is an LDC, Uganda is an LDC, and we're trying to promote East African community. It causes problems. That needs to be looked at, and I think WTO the General Council should take a leading role in that, really clarifying this. What would it take, for instance, to just set up a rule that maybe all countries, say, below a certain per capita income, say, $4,000 or something, will be treated the same under the SDGs, rather than this artificial distinction between LDCs and DCs. I mean, for Africa, for us, it really matters. In terms of the Doha round, the market access that we were promised in agricultural thing, nothing has happened. So I don't really see how WTO can seriously talk about helping SDGs, I think, from the African point of view, unless there's really any renewed impetus in this area. Maybe I'm ignorant, but I haven't seen any concrete action on the part of WTO to really help us in the TRIPS thing in terms of access to technology. And that needs to also be put on the agenda much more strongly than it has been so far. So far, it's all been trade facilitation and all these other things. And lastly, I was reading about a review of aid for trade. And frankly, when I look at what they claim that since 2006 to 2015, about 246 billion thing has been given for aid for trade. And I look at the things that they claim that finance, about 110 for capacity facilitation, about another 120 or so for infrastructure. And I ask myself, in what sense is this addition as a result of WTO? These are, in a sense, traditional development projects that these donors have been pursuing all along. In what sense can one really say that this is additionality and is really helping to make good the type of instruments that were taken away from developing countries, and therefore this is helping? It seems to be, is it really a way of basically creative accounting? Or is there really any meat in that aid for trade agenda beyond the policy and then the basically trade facilitation at the ports thing? When you get into the capacity enhancing and infrastructure, is there any additionality that's really coming in to help countries really grow as a result of and to make good for what the WTO took away from the traditional instruments of that countries have used to develop? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ansel. You raise very interesting questions. You know, the big question of aid for trade additionality has been, you know, going on for some time. It's a question that comes up at every aid for trade review. The issue of S&D and the importance to have a differentiation, you know, among the developing countries' classification is really a big question now, especially that it has sort of affected the how negotiations are being viewed in this regard. Mia, may I invite you to share with us your thoughts on review and monitoring of trade in the respect of the 23rd agenda. Your views.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much. There are advantages and disadvantages of speaking last in the panel. I'm sure I will, have problem to bring something that was not said. But on the other hand, I will not shortchange the audience because they have heard the most important things already. I think this is the third day of our deliberations, and we have, in almost all sessions, we have linked in one way, directly, indirectly, trade and Agenda 2030. So what we are trying to do here is really look into, in a more concrete way, what WTO through the General Council can contribute through operationalization of these goals. Therefore, I'm not going to go into the issues that are still on the table and open, and in terms of the debate whether trade has been reflected sufficiently or not through the SDGs. I mean, one can count the number of term trade that it appears in the document. Someone did it after the Doha Development Agenda with the development, right? I don't know whether people have done it for SDGs yet, but it is I think indicative that it doesn't, even though it is a means of implementation and it's supposed to be cross-cutting, it does not really appear in some of the goals that seem to be, you know, just the right goals to have trade there, like poverty, right, and peace. So we could have done better job. There is a claim that trade community was not able to properly reflect the issues and concerns to the drafters of these. But let's leave it aside. What I want to focus on here is really how do we what we have now. We have SDGs. We have some targets. We are trying to develop indicators. How do we actually involve WTO more? As Deb rightly said, we cannot develop this without WTO. To help us monitor what we need to monitor, and this is where the, I think, still the disconnect is. What do we have to monitor under trade? Because when you look at the goals that are related explicitly to trade, and the language that was used now in terms of the targets, it is rather looking maybe a 20th century wide backwards rather than forwards, right? Because everything is related to commodity and manufacturing trade. Everything is related to border barriers. There is no explicit language to something that is really describing the contemporary international relations between the countries, which are linked through GVCs, through services trade, through movement of investment, through mobility of labor, and of course through the exchange of ideas and technology. So when you look at what you have and what you would need to have to help move development further, there is a I feel certain gap, and looking at these goals and targets that we have, they are as we have discussed recently in ESCAP meeting, and Dev was there as well. They are rather mercantilistic oriented, right? They are dealing with increase of trade as the trade is means in itself, rather than means to the development. So we are not really looking at what the doubling of export will achieve, because we are not asking what exports, right? So if you're just going to double what you do now, will it actually increase your skill set? Will it increase your capacity to expand further? Will it be just export of commodities that you have at present? Or are we asking the right question of what you need to, or how to qualify that increase in trade with the quality requirements so that the actual improvement in development is made. There are a number of other issues that relate back to what can we measure given the data that we have at present, right? I think the reflection of what goals are in there and indicators are in there is really based on the data that we have at present, rather than looking forward and saying, okay, what we would need to measure, and then what sort of data we need for that, and let's go and collect this data and provide, make sure that we have statistics on that. When you discuss trade and equality, a big issue, big part of that is gender. It is not possible to do proper analysis, impact analysis, on how trade liberalization impacts and gender. It is all, you know, part of case studies and maybe some occasional primary data collection, but we don't actually go out and ask firms how do they react to these with respect to then gender impact. I think similar things are also related to climate. We don't really have proper statistics to be able to address these issues. And so looking at statistics, what can we do and what WTO can do is it definitely can, I think in a way it has started doing it already, but it has to be done in a more formal way. It can help development of data sets that would then enable countries to reformulate these indicators in a way that they would be meaningful in terms of the achievement of the goals. They can also, I think, more formally, as Deb suggested, include these through the TPR. But also, I think what would be important, and I think that is the role of the General Council, to perhaps look at put these issues of competition, investment, etc., more to the agenda of the WTO, so that it feeds back into the behavior of countries. Let me stop there, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Mia, for those thoughts. Before I give the opportunity to the floor to make comments and ask questions. Deb, the the Doha round, arose, after the momentum of the launch of the MDGs. What do you see coming out of the SDGs at that level from the WTO? Or do you see anything at all?
What do you see? Well, some questions have rhetorical answer in certain way. You see, it's a very peculiar situation. As you all know, the SDGs in September were signed by all the countries of the world who are members of the United Nations. And some of the countries now, currently, are trying to dismantle Doha Round. So I just don't understand whether they are taking orders from the same government or not. Because they signed under Article 17.10 goal in SDG, which says universal rule-based, etc., trading system, including through conclusion of negotiations under the Doha Development Agenda. So there is a concrete direct directive on Doha Development Agenda over there. So I know this is not mandatory. These are aspirational. But it has moral strictures too. So I find that those who are now arguing that Doha Round is de facto dead and we will have to look beyond through other means or other things, that I do not follow totally at all. This is a major political issue which one has to look into. The second point is that, but having said that, we are not also stupid that we will remain hostage to something which is not working. You know, this is Einstein who said that you are definitely stupid if you go on repeating the same experiment and getting the same results and hoping something different will happen. So if that be the case, we'll have to bring in some creativity in the thinking. But that creativity would come more in terms of modalities how to pursue, not at the cost of the concerns and interests which gave rise to Doha Round. Because those concerns remain valid. So we are talking about more about tactics here, or the modalities, less about the strategies over there or the particular objectives over here. So I find a second round of problem over there. How do you distinguish between that? Some of the colleagues have been propagating plurilateralism, some of them possibly going for the mega trade blocks and other things. So some obviously on universal road of liberalization and others. So those things are there. But we'll have to think of something which on the one hand, you know, preserves the core fundamental concerns which gave rise to Doha Round, and on the other hand, ability to respond to the emerging new realities. So this is the in-between, where do we stand at this moment. But whether that can be done by conclusion of Doha Round with complementary measures, with supplementary covenants or treaties, that is something to be seen over there. What we understand now, these bits and pieces, the small mercies like rules of origin here and there, fisheries subsidy regularization over it there, doesn't really justify the amount of money I have spent to come to Nairobi.
This reminds me, back in 1992, when the Uruguay round was going nowhere, we had several books that were talking about the stumbling block versus building block issue of regionalism versus multilateralism in those days. And we had several conferences and books that were written on that. And one of the issues was regionalism going against multilateralism in terms of opening markets. And, you know, in the end, when you look at it, it hasn't been the case that they've gone one against the other. But what has been happening progressively is that the WTO is losing relevance. Now, if you think about the SDGs, you know, what is really happening now? Just take the TPP as an example. In those mega regional, you're going to start moving around in terms of taking measures eventually that are good for the environment. And nothing is likely, you know, to happen if you don't go towards a positive contract. And I think that's the big issue. The WTO is going to become more or less irrelevant unless the countries agree to do it multilaterally, but they're going to find it better to do it regionally.
Thank you, Jamie. Christoph, you have some views on that?
Yes, maybe just to build a little bit on what has been said. I think that it's important that we try to understand what is happening now with the WTO. I agree with Deb when he says it's difficult to understand why, on the one hand, you have in the 2030 agenda a call for concluding the Doha round and multilateralism and so on and so forth, and on the other hand, you're seeing nothing happening in the WTO. But I think one has to see that what has changed, and that's maybe where I would disagree a little bit with Jim DeMello, is that we are now in a situation where all the big powers have completely lost interest in the WTO. And why? Essentially because they achieved all the things they wanted to achieve through a Doha round. They achieved that through their plurilaterals, through their TPP and... So the problem that we have now is for developing countries who are trying to get something out of these big players. If you take agriculture subsidies, African countries or developing countries, you need to remove those subsidies. They're creating distortions. You're dumping your food. You're destroying our markets and our farmers. The US and the EU might have been willing to do that earlier in the context of a bigger round. Now they've got what they wanted through the TPP, through TTIP, and so on and so on. They've lost interest. The problem is an issue of leverage. What kind of leverage can developing countries use to advance their concern in the multilateral trading system? And that leverage has completely disappeared. So I think that's, as we move forward, the important thing is to try to understand how can we regain some kind of leverage in these negotiations to make sure that the big guys get some interest back in the multilateral trading system or move towards the kind of things we want to achieve.
Thank you. Mia, before if we leave the negotiations aside, obviously the WTO is more than the negotiations. There are the things that the WTO does. And I keep saying that, this characteristic we give to WTO because of the negotiations is basically saying, you know, it makes WTO basically a victim of its high ambition. But there are other good things that the WTO is engaged in. What other interventions outside the negotiation pillar could we strengthen in order to support the SDGs?
Thank you for this nice distributive act. Well, it's definitely, you know, WTO obviously has been much appreciated through the dispute settlement role, etc. But let me focus on the other role that has been put in place by the establishment, but then enhanced after the crisis through the monitoring of trade policies and surveillance of trade policies. And I think this is the area where it can be strengthened. So far, the transparency in that should be strengthened, because at present, countries take this as, you know, secular Catholics will take religion. They don't go to church, but they claim that they adhere to the rules. And so countries preach to transparency, but they don't notify. And so it's very difficult to understand at any given point of time what are the change in trade policies and how do you then digest from these changes whether the countries are actually fulfilling their roles with respect, for example, to the developing countries in terms of better treatment or not. But further to that, I think it would be important to work with the countries and developing their capacity to understand the trade policy making and monitoring of these. and through the ITTC of the WTO. Some work has been done, and ESCAP is engaged together with the WTO since 1999 in Asia and Pacific to strengthen capacity of developing countries in that area. I think what was said here for the aid for trade is very correct. Lots of money is claimed to be spent, but we really don't know how much of that landed in developing opportunities for trade for these countries, and maybe strengthening of that arm can be done as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Ansu. Do you have some thoughts on this matter?
You know, from the African perspective, I'm saying, okay, now if the developed countries themselves who brought this about are running away from the WTO, then for developing countries, what have we really gotten out of this? I mean, the advent of the WTO, we can see concrete restrictions that were put on our policy space with a lot of promises on other things that will get better. I haven't seen any clear manifestation of any of those promises. And so to us, we're just wondering, as we go forward, how do we really make WTO work for us? Doha hasn't been delivered. A lot of the things on the trips that haven't been delivered. The SDTs are MS. And so I think, and it seems that a lot of the action has been on the trade facilitation, which is welcome. It's part of it, but it's part of a chain. If you don't have anything, you're not competitive in producing anything that somebody wants, you can trade. And to do that, to be able to be that competitive in the production sector, we need a number of things that focus needs to be there much more prominently than it is. Right now, it's not just all trade lawyers talking about trading preferences. And I don't see how that speaks to us.
Thank you. I now turn to our participants, and if you have a question or a contribution, make it as brief as possible.
Solution.
Or solution, indeed. Make it as brief as possible to the point. If you have a question or contribution, please state your name and organization where you're coming from, or if you're individual, just say so. Questions, contributions, the floor is open. Break the ice, please.
So I want to make Deb a little bit happy for paying to come
please.
Here. So you said if fishery subsidies is one of the things you mentioned.
Could you introduce yourself first so that we get to know
okay.
you?
Okay, I'm Rashid Sumaila from the University of British Columbia in Vancouver. And I said I wanted to make Deb a bit happy. If we are able to get fishery subsidies taken away, you should be happy, and there are good reasons for that. Fish is very important to many people in the world, you know that. 260 million people get some income from fish. We take out about 120 million tons, and I love to say that is equivalent to about 120 million cows that we pull out of the ocean each year. That is more than about double what we slaughter from our farms on land. So that is really serious stuff. And it's also good protein. It's better than cow, actually, cow meat, fish meat. So if we can get that, you should be happy, sir.
Thank you. Any the lady over there?
Thank you. I'm Fahmida Khatun from Center for Policy Dialogue, Bangladesh. Even though there is a rise of the mega trade blocs and all, but LDCs would like to always fall back to the WTO. One example here that in SDGs 3, we talk about healthy lives, health for all. And for LDCs, access to affordable medicine is very, very important. And the General Council decision of the Chiefs Council just before the WTO 10th ministerial, the decision to extend the waiver on pharmaceutical products from for LDCs till 2033. I think this was a very welcome decision. Though the demand from the LDCs were that as long as the LDCs are, remain as LDCs, they should be given this waiver. So these decisions, if operationalized, is very important for achieving SDGs goal 3. So I see there is a direct link between these two, you know, the link between WTO decision and the SDGs. Thank you.
To some extent, I think that the LDCs have been able to get something that at least you can move on with. The one next to me. You can have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Excellent presentations. Mustafizur Rahman from Center for Policy Dialogue. My colleague Fahmid has spoken already. Dhaka, Bangladesh. No, I always thought that, you see, the developing countries and the LDCs are the major markets for the developed countries. And we often really forget that. So I think that, and if you look at the trade surplus, it is always in favor of the developed country, you know. So my point is that making the WTO work is in the interest of the developed countries, should be in the medium to long term. And it is the enlightened, it should be the enlightened self-interest of the developed countries to make WTO work. If you give market access, if we get, derogation in terms of special and differential status, if we get TRIPS derogation, etc., these help the developing countries and the least developed countries to grow their economies, and then they have the purchasing power to import from the developed countries. And that's how we are the markets of the developed countries. So I really fail to really appreciate the very narrow focused look at the WTO on the part of the developed countries. So that really confuses me. Because if you have the mega trading blocks or the plurilaterals, you also are excluding a large part of the developing countries from those, your future markets. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take a look at myself at the moment because I'm from an LDC country. One of the issues that we have is that you may, as LDC country, get derogation, but are you effectively utilizing that benefit? We have gotten the services waiver. To what extent are LDCs undertaking reforms or adjustments that will adjust to make sure that they benefit from that waiver? Recognizing, of course, that trade is a means to poverty reduction and you know, ending hunger and so forth. Any other contributions before I... Okay, let me give Mia, and then I'll come to Christoph, and then Jim.
Just because you mentioned services waiver, I think we have... And you flipped it and said, you know, can we utilize the preferences? Because when you analyze what 17 countries so far have been notified as offering, it is very much actually in the water country, then the competition obviously in the market will be much stronger than what the LDC can offer. And, you know, if the country tells you, yeah, you can establish a bank in whatever province of my country, you know, the question is, you know, how contestable the market is and whether you can enter that market. So we have to be quite, I think, sensitive to the capacity of the least developed countries in terms of fulfilling.
Christoph, and then Jim.
No, I just wanted to react to the point made by Mustafizur when he basically said, yes, but the developed countries should have an interest in the developing countries because they're big markets and they're large markets, and therefore that should be something that motivates them to engage in the multilateral trading system. That might very well be the case, but that also explains why now the large, most developed economies are saying, okay, we want to change the terms. We want now emerging economies to really open up their markets. Before, you know, they could say, well, maybe we're not getting a lot on emerging markets, but at least we're getting some concessions in the EU, in Japan, in the developed countries. Now this is over. The only reason why they would continue to engage is if they can get something in the emerging countries. But one of the problems that developing countries have been saying is that, well, this is, you know, a development round. We're trying to address the imbalances that we've had in the past, so they should be special and differential treatment. So developing countries should not be asked to do too much. And, you know, that worked at the beginning. In this new situation, this will be much more difficult.
Jim, you have some comment to that, and please, if you may address this issue of this developing country or emerging countries being classed together with other developing countries.
Yeah, now? Yeah.
It is as good as WTO.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. No, I just wanted to add one comment. I agree completely with what Christoph is saying, but I want to get back to this LDC, I wouldn't say issue. We have, you know, we talk about preferential market access. Now, the developed countries and just about every country in the world is engaged in preferential trading agreements. So, in effect, what are the preferential market access you're giving, once you're taking into account what you're giving to others, 1%. That's the WTO fee, 2%. So we're fighting over 1-2%. Maybe it's more for fish, maybe it's more for textiles, okay. So what do you do? Well, for LDCs, and that's the question, the LDC is a recognized category. It may not be perfect, and some people say, well, you know, we should erase the LDC, not LDCs, as we've done for CBDR, you know, for the climate. But, you know, at least it is allowed in the WTO. Otherwise, the only thing you can do, which is what countries have done, is to give it unilaterally. So in unilaterally, you know, if the AGOA, EBA, you can give preferences. But if you want to do it via the multilateral system, you can't do it unless it's a recognized category like small islands, LDCs. So I wanted to do, so the question of what we need to do with the LDC classification is beyond, you know, is beyond discussion here, but it's something that should be addressed. And one last thing about the climate clubs, if ever you would have a coalition of the willing among, or it's not all, but let's say among those countries that should do something. Now, who are the ones that should do something? Let's say on climate and SDGs. Well, SDGs, you could say everyone. So on climate, you would have the emerging countries, not just the OECD, but also the emerging. So you may have free riding in that. So you would want to have the opportunity or to change the rules so that you could put tariffs on WTO members that are not part of the club. They don't want to put a CO2 tax. Now you can't do that. Okay, you cannot put a tariff on another member. It's not in the rules so far. So if WTO wants to maintain relevance in some way, which of course we would all like it to do, we would have to need to some changes in the rules.
Thank you. Debbie wanted to add to that.
I think this whole issue why things are not happening the way it used to be is we all understand that the whole economic geography is going through a tectonic shift. The problem is that we are living in a world when the stronger parties have no more control and the rising parties cannot also impose their will. I think that is the current situation as we stand. The interesting, and that is why long time back Jagdish Bhagwati wrote about United States, the diminishing giant syndrome. So the diminishing giant is now trying to find other ways of going around the bypassing the multilateral system. So till that time comes when the trade, investment, or other financial flows issues, the new emerging countries, along with others, developing countries, really conclusively establishes their dominance. And that's the way it is going, incidentally, notwithstanding the fall in commodity prices. Then we'll see that. Now, the issue is that how long it will take, this thing, particularly in the context of the changing global scenario and the new politics which will come into existence in the context of the challenges from global security. That is something which is to be seen, because the picture is getting complicated now, because trade, investment, or development concerns are now being, in the 2016 onward, will be more, you know, become subsidiary to the availability of global public goods like peace and security. So on that sense, you will see a lot of new compromises being done here and there. And the issue is whether it will have positive fallout for WTO or trade agreements or not. That is something one will have to see. This is a new circumstances altogether, the new risks and opportunities we are talking about. Now, coming to the more mundane issue of WTO and how it goes in that way, and whether we have alternatives or not. We have to note that the southern emerging countries in the recent past, in the last 5 years, 7 years, have also offered unilateral market access to the LDCs. Many countries have done that. And we have assessed them, sometimes good, sometimes bad, but with potential. So that will increase, irrespective of WTO, hopefully, as we move in certain ways. And that will move both unilaterally, bilaterally, and sub-regionally. That is how it is going. We should also take into account that also new institutions coming into existence, which is putting competition on the traditional international financial institutions. We have what you call Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank over there, solely financed by Chinese, and others are coming in, some grudgingly coming in. So you are seeing responses, new institutions to fall back. The BRIC banks are supposed to come in on board. And if you see in certain point in time, and if you look at what is happening, is that China, India, Brazil are doing China, India, the China Africa Summit, India is doing Africa Summit. So these are the new things which are also happening. We only talk about TPP, TTIP, but we all forget that there are other things also happening within the developing countries. Those things are less studied and less mentioned in many ways as we go. So I don't think that this whole hang-up with the WTO mechanism, and I am one of those addicted ones, we once made living out of it. And the issue is that there are other things we'll have to bring into existence. So if you want the big pan canvas thing, what I see, there had been a thesis 1996, coming to 96 up to 2001. Then there was the period of antithesis. This is currently going on. And I foresee there will be a situation, will evolve into a situation of synthesis. Synthesis will come after some times, and when all these things will possibly settle down. But in between what we do, that is an interesting issue. Now, my good friend Rashid said that fisheries subsidy is no less small mercy. How many cows you said?
Cows.
So you see, I'm overwhelmed in that way. But what I will say is that, you know, God giveth in one hand, taketh in another, as usual. So I'm pretty sure you're going to read the small details in the footprints, in the end notes and others, where how it is going to operate, whether there will be cap, there will be other, you know, allowable subsidies, whether how the subsidies will be counted at the end or up there in the upstream. We all know all those things on that. So I remain optimistic, but cautiously optimistic.
Thank you. Any questions from the audience? Please go ahead.
Hello, my name is Emily Kennedy. I'm with the Food Rights Alliance in Uganda. My focus with them is looking at cross-generational knowledge transfer in relation to food and water security. One of the things that I've been noticing is that there's a growing disinterest in youth being involved in food production, be it in agriculture or fisheries. Just wondering how we address that and what you think that means for the future of trade and food security.
We will take another question.
Thank you. She has already tackled the youth question, which was my number one. The next one is there commitment in giving punitive measures to waste management, those countries who don't conform? And then the other one is land reclaiming. What impact is it having on temperature rising? Can we have safer agrochemicals to preserve soils? Thank you. My name is Annette from Mother and Child TV.
Is there a third question from the audience? If not, please go ahead.
Yes, hello, Francis Johnson with Stockholm Environment Institute. You have discussed a little bit climate change, but mostly with regard to CO2 tax as a measure in the reform. But since there was just a climate agreement a few days ago, and it's too early to analyze it, but I wonder if anyone would like to comment on the opportunities that will come out for aligning trade and climate. Maybe, perhaps, for example, if the trade has been headed in a regional direction, maybe you could combine regional climate agreements with regional trade agreements, for example.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the questions. I would turn to the panelists to address the questions, the climate change questions from the two participants. James, could you address those?
And that's a question. Those are two very good questions. And indeed, this is one of the, I can't say it means it'll be a collision course between climate and trade. But right now, whatever countries' preferences are, whatever you want to define it, with respect to environmental policies, is something that they can do on their own as long, you know, as they are not undoing what they have exchanged at the WTO, which is non-discrimination and natural treatment. That means that when it comes to the question you have, what we do about countries that don't want to take care of their waste, what do we do about countries that are deforesting and so on? And the answer to that is, under the current regime, there's not much we can do. Actually, there's nothing in the WTO regime where addressing the environment is compulsory as in there. In the opening of my remarks, I said there's too much that is left at this stage in terms of environmental policies to the consumer, as opposed to a decision that would be taken that would say, all right, we're going to say that we can have, let's say, cement clinkers, which is very important, CO2 emission. What could we do? Well, we could say that you can brand, but we don't have that yet, at HS8 or some kind of level where you could make a distinction between the two and put treat them differently. We don't have any. The same thing for waste management. For forests, we have something called the Red Plus, but it's a good idea, but still it hasn't worked as well as we hoped for. As to your question, yes, I mean, I think I did sort of address it, or somewhat. It is being addressed in regional trade agreements as opposed to doing that multilaterally. And if you just look at the EGA, which has been going on now, remember that there were two important mandates in Doha. What was the Doha round? The Doha round was the round for developing countries and the environment. So countries were mandated to do fisheries, and they were mandated to do environmental goods. Article 2831, after 15 years, not much has happened. And the EGA, what is interesting in it is it's finally a club of countries have started doing something. So we're getting there in a way, but it's still difficult to get there. And that's the problem, even with the club approach.
Thank you, Jim. Christoph, your response to the food security issue, as well as any concluding remarks you may have.
Yes. Well, there was a question about youth and why young people don't want to get into agriculture in Africa. But I think I should leave to my African colleague, who probably knows better than I the reasons why this is happening. I just wanted to react to the point on the importance of the Paris Agreement. I think one very important impact And we've seen that in the past. Whenever we have the progress in those agreements, that has generated important political signals for enhanced investment, particularly in clean energy, renewable energy, and so on and so forth. And if you actually even map the investment and research and so on and so forth, you can even maybe see a parallel between the conclusion of these agreements and higher investment in those areas. So one can hope that this Paris Agreement is providing the kind of long-term legal security that some investors might want to invest increasingly in clean energy. And then trade will play a very important role in making sure that these technologies are diffused in different countries, that they're being made available in different parts of the world. Not everyone is going to become leading producers of wind or solar or whatever. So through trade, I think we can make sure that these investments then result in a diffusion of clean energy technologies.
The question of the youth, if you may have thoughts, as you know, we are having a huge number of youths entering the labor market in Africa. How do we tackle that if they are not being absorbed in agriculture and food production? And your concluding remarks, please.
Thank you. Of course, it is a very important issue. And in fact, my organization, African Center for Economic Transformation, are currently working on a report which we hope to release towards the end of next year on how do you transform agriculture in Africa. And one of the issues is how do you really get the youth, how do you create a middle of a small and medium scale commercial farming sector in Africa that the educated youth would want to take up as a vocation. That requires a whole lot of work from skills development, infrastructure, agricultural policy, and everything else. But it would also, you don't go in there because it doesn't pay compared to other things. And how do you make it pay? And how do you equip them to do it? And most of it, of course, would be internal African government issue. But to the extent that a big part of it will be basically upgrading value addition and upgrading position in value chains and being able to export, I think the Doha agenda and market opening in agriculture and the WTO role would become important. Those are my concluding remarks.
Thank you, Ansu. Mia, your concluding remarks?
I may, because this youth problem is actually not an African problem, it's a global problem, and we have encountered that in Asia as well. And the solution has been already, or the part to the solution provided. It's the problem is that the agricultural production and food production is often linked to unstable income and very difficult labor conditions and living conditions, and therefore you want to change that, right? You want to link that production with high value added based on education, technology, and everything. And so this is a long-term process. It's structural adjustment and structural transformation. And what the Asians are now doing is actually trying to bring, because also there is an impetus for youth to go to the city for whatever reason. So they are trying to bring the good sides of the cities to the rural sides, information technology in particular, so that they don't feel excluded from those. And then obviously incentives for the education and stuff like that. So thank you.
Thank you, Deb. Concluding remarks.
Yes, I think the subject of this particular session was agenda for the General Council. As you can see, that the discussion has gone much beyond the reach of the General Council. What does it mean? Does it mean that your expectations are so high from the General Council? I really don't know. That is our aspiration that it should not be these important issues. You see, let me come back to the General Council, since I spent some time in preparing a memo, is that It will all depend what the General Council will do, how the Nairobi ends. So Nairobi will outcome will provide a benchmark or threshold for the General Council to operate. So broadly, three scenarios are being contemplated. No? One is an entrenched disharmony with which we go back home. And so essentially a breakdown or collapse or the way it was there in many ways, which reminds us of the 2008 July ministerial in Geneva. This is one. The second is that we end with platitudes and business as usual. We go back home, try to figure out what is a post-Nairobi work plan and et cetera, et cetera. And the third is that something extraordinary happens and we get some substantive solutions. So depending upon these three, it will all depend how the General Council will react. So on that, my whole point is that if we end up with disharmony here, you know, with a conflictual outcome, one cannot expect that the General Council should take a lead political leadership in dealing with SDGs or 20,000 agenda. So they are interrelated in many ways because they are symbiotic in that way. And I want to also disappoint our climate expert friends that you expect that Doha round will not go anywhere, but the climate issue will be dealt with at the WTO substantively based on the COP21. This is too much to expect. Because if the traditional issues do not get solved up to a point, the new issues will not get traction in that particular way. And as you understand, General Council is not an autonomous agent. It is a proxy for our governments. And when the governments, our governments do make utterances of public virtue and commit private sins, the mismatch between those two, and which we have seen in G20 declaration. G20 declaration had at least four times said, conclude Doha round immediately. And the ministers forgot to inform their ambassadors in Geneva. So you see, that is the political, what you see, public virtue and private sin which is happening. So till that time, I don't see really General Council really taking that lead and depending upon the outcome we are going to have over here. But that should not stop us from writing a memo for them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you, panelists, for the contributions you've made. In a nutshell, obviously there are many interventions that have been identified from the functions of the WTO that can go to address contributes to the SDGs. Most of those interventions are linked to the success of the negotiations. However, we have also identified that there are some other functions of the WTO that can go to address the SDGs. But the starting point, as Deva said, is to put the SDG issues on the agenda of the General Council. And Deb will write a memo to that effect. So may I take this opportunity to thank again our esteemed panelists. Please give them an applause. Thank you for participants for your engagement and for taking time to be here. I particularly thank my colleague, Ali Stipping, who's at the back, for putting together this panel discussion. So thank you, and enjoy the rest of the day, and bon appétit.